thank you for making time for us. I know you guys are so busy. And don't you have a campaign today, a schedule?
Mostly online so far. Kasi I think they're also trying to be careful na to make sure we're compliant with the COMELEC guidelines. So a lot of the, para may some face-to-face, but mostly series of Zoom calls.
I see. Aika, you're still with the microfinance NGO?
Yes, ma'am.
But are you on leave?
No. Kasi walang matitira sa NGO. So I think what's gonna happen is when it gets busier, there will be some days that I'll be away for the campaign, but I cannot do a full-time leave kasi hindi gagalaw yung organization. And there's Jillian.
Hi, Jillian. Nice to see you. Alam ko may exams ka, so we will so you can. Are you ano? What time is it there? It's ano? 9.
It's almost 10. 12 hours. Yeah. Taktong 12 hours.
Okay, you're looking good, ha? Huh? Para YC becomes you. Anyway, so Aika, we were just to start this. Parang you can. So our readers will know. You can tell a few things about yourself, what you're doing now. And just so you know, we'll have this also in YouTube, aside from the long form essay that the diaries has. So, Aika, what makes you choose that NGO? Your work, can you describe the work, your work here?
So, right now, I'm the executive director of Restart Microenterprise, Inc. It's essentially a microfinance nonprofit that focuses on post-disaster livelihood recovery. So prior to graduate school, I actually worked in OCD, or it's siguro NDRRMC is more familiar to some other people, but my work was focused on disaster management. And then when I got back after I finished my master's, that's how I ended up in Restart Me. Initially to set up the NGO, but right now, it's also timely that we're in the middle of a pandemic, so it's also a busy time for us since the focus is disaster livelihood recovery for the MSMEs. So that's the shortcut version,
to be remembered. So you help them cope with disasters.
Yes, ma'am.
Teams, no?
Yes, yes. So before pre-pandemic, we usually come in after a typhoon or after an earthquake, or we still have existing projects in Marawi after the Marawi siege. Essentially, anything that causes economic disturbances to these micro entrepreneurs. But now the problem with COVID is that it feels like it's not over yet, so it's an ongoing disaster, and our goal is to really just help them get back on their feet and transition into a more, I guess, hopefully to help them normalize their business as part of their recovery.
To get back on their feet. How about you, Dr. Tricia? Are you with any, you still do volunteer work, or aside from the campaign? What are you busy with?
I still do regular duties actually. I just came from a duty last night. So I still do ER work. Unfortunately, the hospital where I'm working, we're kind of short staffed. So I really can't be working for the camp. I mean, hindi pa nagsimula yung campaign, but I can't also do full time there because I have responsibilities in the hospital. I was supposed to start my training in internal medicine but then life happened, so I have to delay that for a while. I was supposed to start in January, but because I'm needed elsewhere, I might have to delay by a few months, but that's the plan ko talaga. I'll specialize in internal medicine. Aside from hospital work, I've been doing research as well. So, ayun po, I've been juggling several things here and there. So,
okay. And Jillian, what made you choose your course?
So now, currently, senior na ako in NYU. So, graduating na ako in May. I'm doing a double major in math and econ. Kaya medyo hectic pa rin kahit senior year. So, I guess for me, hindi pa ako ganun kaset on my career path. So, medyo general. I think mas general lang yung econ and math. And ever since, kasi gusto ko rin yung math. So, medyo mixed din siya. And honestly, si mama econ major before. So, I think nakuha ko rin yung interest ko in econ from her. So, ayun.
So, how are you, how often do you see your mom now that there's a campaign going on? And anyone can answer, huh?
Well, okay, but we still see her every night. We still try to wait for her so we can all have dinner at the same time. Although sometimes she comes in a little later than usual. But yeah, it's usually early morning before she leaves and then late at night when she gets home.
Do you call her mama?
Mama.
Okay. So have you, like Jillian, have you come to terms with your decision? Because your mom posted in FB that you were the one who was hard hit by that decision. But you guys, I suppose, saw it coming, diba? Because the demand was building up. So have you come to terms, Jillian, with the decision?
I think naman nung simula nung nag-announce na siya. So I think that was like on a Thursday in Manila, October 7 ba or something. I think nung time na yun, parang, alam, dahil andyan na, wala ka na rin choice kundi to support it. And I think nakatulong din na sobrang daming positive like feedback or like ang daming positive reactions sa social media. So I think yung isa sa kinakatakutan ko, I think the last 5 years, in my head at least, hindi ko alam kung same with my siblings. In my head, parang karamihan ng tao or like the majority, ayaw talaga kay mama. So I think yun yung concern ko na pag sumabak siya sa laban, sobrang, alam mo yun, medyo mauubos na talaga yung energy namin lahat. So I guess like seeing everyone lang during that day wearing pink, na talagang nag-aabang yung speech niya, siguro mas easier to accept or mas easier na wala, to plunge in the campaign. Ayun. Malamang may i-add pa yung dalawa kong kapatid din.
Yeah. Please do.
Yeah. Sige, add ako kay Jill. I think, kami kasi po ni ate ay, yun nga, yung kinikwento niya, sabay-sabay kami lagi kumain. And kami sa pamilya, as the events are happening, pinatext na namin sa isa't isa. Because we have a thread online. So, parang in essence, we were updated kung anong nangyayari, what was happening with the unification talks, where they were. So, hindi siya necessarily we saw it coming, but then we saw the possibility of it happening. So, I guess when it was time for my mom to finally decide, she didn't even have to tell us explicitly that she was gonna run. We just basically understood that yun yung mangyayari. But of course, up until the last minute, we were hoping na hindi siya mangyari. This was not how we envisioned the end of 2021 and the start of 2022. Pero, ayun, natanggap na lang naman po namin at katulad po ng sabi ni Jillian, nakatulong talaga to see the outpour of support. Alam namin na hindi kami alone sa laban na to. So, malaking tulong po talaga yun. And I guess now that we're here, feeling ko all in na rin naman kami. We're not gonna leave our respective classes, our work, but then when my mom needs us, as much as possible, we try to be available.
Yeah, Aika.
Yeah, I think that's also the sort of the compromise, I think, or something that parang yung deal din ni mama with all of us na kumbaga, minimal disruption with what we are doing now. And like what my sibling said, it's really helpful. It really helped us a lot to see na parang a lot of people also feel that they have a big stake in this campaign in next year. Kasi at least from our point of view, especially when we felt that my mom will run na talaga, na I hope we don't see it as a personality na it's just really Lenny. It's more of, you know, who or what she represents. And it just so happened na siguro siya yung figure, siya yung face, I guess, of this campaign. But what we are hoping also is that in the next couple of months and even beyond, na this is really ours. It's not just hers. It's ours. It's all of us. And that's what we were hoping for. And seeing people really participate and also dive in the even at this early part of the campaign. Siguro it helps, especially kami na kasi sa amin when my mom, when we felt that my mom was set on running, parang secondary na lang na thoughts how is she going to win, how many people will help her, etc. All we knew at that time, or all we knew before she announced, is that okay, if she's gonna need our help, then you know we'll be around, we will show up and we'll help her. But yeah, seeing our social media feeds turn pink, and then seeing how invested our friends are as well. So malaking bagay siya sa amin, and it really gives us a lot of energy to keep moving forward.
When did you feel she made up her mind, or when she told you? When did she tell?
She didn't really tell us. She like it wasn't a family meeting that she had to sit us down and tell us na, by the way, guys, I'm right. It wasn't like that. Siguro it came maybe a couple of weeks before she announced, because we knew what kind of meetings were going on, and we knew that if this meeting resulted to this, then it's probably a go for her. Or if para sa ano, it's really more of a process thing. It's not like do we want to or bawal ba. It's more of what were the different factors that came into play at that time, you know, weighing all of these things. And I guess dahil firsthand knowing mama the way that we know her, we knew that was how it was going to end up at some point.
We got questions from our Viber chats, so it's very representative of the people, well, of course our echo chamber, but still, like from Chelsea Yasai, whose husband was in government, no? Politics in Philippines is very dirty. How can you help your mom deal with the garbage thrown her way? Is this a place you want her to be in? That's her question. Any one of you can answer.
I think the best way to help our mom really is we won't stoop down to the dirtiness of politics. Because the past couple of years, it wasn't just thrown against her. In a way, nadamay din doon magkakapatid for various reasons. Naalala namin kami ni Ate Aika, if anything triggered us the most, it was when parang may ginawa ng fake news yung bunso namin, which we felt was unfair. She was still in high school, pero tinitira sa atin lang. But I guess yung pinaka-contribution namin sa mom namin, is to, aside from to look after one another, it's more of, hindi na kami mabatol. Ayaw na din namin makagulong. And, ayun, I think na natulog din po kaming parang to drown out the noise and to focus on what's important. And pakiramdam ko na katulog din ng maayos yung nanay namin paggabi, knowing that hindi kami na yung kasama sa kadumihan niya. Kasi nasistress po si mama kapag kami nasistress. And sure, we can handle it also the way we can handle it. Sana naman nakatulong yun sa kanya. Alam namin mabigat yung dinadala niya araw-araw. Pero sana yung mga ginagawa natin. But I think may madadagay din ako kapag ito po. Sa sagot.
Yeah, I think both our parents have been in politics since you were young. So maybe siguro yung in terms of the dirtiness of it all, siguro na scale up lang siya when my mom became VP. And that's something we had to live with for the past 5 or 6 years. And if anything, siguro it trained us already not to be too affected by all the noise. And I guess what's important for us is to, siguro nga, sometimes to a fault, that it's apparently we found the technique already to switch off the, or to turn on the blinder so we don't get affected by what's being said online. What's important is that alam namin kung ano yung totoo, that's one. And then second, siguro kung ano kami before all this, hopefully we are better versions of ourselves today than who we were at the beginning. Always tuloy-tuloy lang and unaffected by everything else.
Javi, you have question?
Yes, ma'am. Hi guys, good morning. I'm Javi from U. Jill, my friends Miguel Paje and David De Magueba told me to say hi from them.
Oh, but
I was just with them last weekend. But anyway, for my first question, I was listening to your family podcast last night with your mom, and you talked a lot about your childhood in Naga City. My first question, just to start us off, would be, what do you miss the most about Naga City now that you're all in different places right now? Anyone can start.
I think yung pinaka kung place wise siguro yung mas malaking bahay tirahan lang namin sa Naga kasi sa Manila naka condo lang kaming lahat, cramped kami in one condo, and especially now in New York mas maliit yung mga size ng mga tirahan dito. So siguro one yung space, yung bahay namin sa Naga, super cozy, and I think lahat kami, well at least ako, buong childhood ko doon ako lumaki. So ang dami lang memories na with the lolos at lolas, with papa. So kasi after the year after namatay si papa, we moved na to Manila. So I guess yung pinaka na miss ko lang in Naga talaga is the space that we have, and siguro yung hindi ganun ka traffic, pero hindi na yung place, more of like the thought na lang na walang traffic.
Aika.
Ako, it's being, I guess, being close to anywhere. Parang when in Naga, every, parang kung yung travel time mo is more than 20 minutes, that's considered really far already. So like from our house to a lolo's house, or from our house to say the mall or the church, parati siyang nasa mga 10 to 15 minutes lang na travel time. It's easy to go around the city relatively. So the proximity of everything. And before also, when we still lived in Naga, we used to have, ngayon kasi dinner na lang kami sabay-sabay. But since everything was close to each other in Naga, kahit lunch, kaya namin to eat together as a family.
Tricia, you have
ayun po talaga. I think it's been like for me when I transferred to Manila for college, especially kasi ate po nag-dorm siya nung nasa Manila, but then I moved with my dad. So isa-isa lang kami place para tipid din, para we don't have to pay the dorm and then we don't have to pay for rent. But then because of that, I had to travel to Ateneo. And kahit within QC lang siya, ang hirap, sobrang traffic. And honestly, isa po yun sa major factors kung taga-province ka, tapos sumipat ka ng Manila, the travel time is really insane for us. Yung 30 minutes pa lang sa amin ang layo na, pero if I can get to school at the time in 30 minutes, ang saya ko na. So yeah, I think the proximity talaga is something that I miss. But then for some reason, I always felt safe in Naga also. Na parang walang mangyayaring masama sa akin kapag nasa Naga ako. I don't know if it's because of familiarity or if it's because of the general atmosphere lang na ganap or everyone's so friendly, magkakakilala lahat ng tao because it's a small place. So I think that's one of the things that I really miss in the province. Parang feeling ko sa Manila, lagi dapat nakikipagbalyahan ka kasi kung hindi malilate ka or basta parang ganun. Yung general atmosphere lang talaga sa Naga is something I really miss a lot. And yung sinabi nga po ni Ate Jillian, because of how convenient everything is in the province, I get to see them more. Hindi naman kami naging less close nung nag-move kami sa Manila because again, because of technology, lagi pa rin kami magkausap. Pero just seeing each other lagi na face to face, I think that's something I miss a lot, which I won't say kung wala tayo sa interview na to, kasi pagkatawanan ako ng mga kapatid ko, sabihin lang sentimental ko. But I really miss having all five of us together in one place. So, pandagdag lang sa mga sinabi nila kasi na talaga yung sagot ko.
There's a question from Minda Ruiz. She's a mom, obviously, from St. Teresa. Why do you think the young are rooting for, I won't use her words, okay, BBM? Don't they know what happened during martial law? I guess she's asking about your generation.
Wow, sino tayo? No, ako honestly, siguro number one, I don't think we can blame the young. If anything, I think tayo siguro who should understand more. Kumbaga, we, in a way, that's also our responsibility. Although, disclaimer, I was born after EDSA already. I was born in 1988. But I think siguro a big part of it is number one is medyo education din. I think I was lucky enough na at least siguro yung generation ko, siguro at that time, maybe EDSA was still fresh and it was still often talked about. And it was easy at that time to maybe correct kung ano man yung misconception of what happened o kung ano talaga yung nangyari sa history natin. So in a way, we para it's hard to say na we can fault the young for thinking the way that they do. If anything, siguro challenge yun for us to be able to educate them better. There has to be a better way for us to be able to help them realize and understand history better. But I guess, kami kasi ng mga sisters ko, we are 6 years apart. So siguro iba-iba yung sagot namin sa question na to. Ako born ako closer to post-EDSA. And I think iba-iba rin sila.
Well, ayun. So inamin din ng kapatid ko na magkakaibang generasyon. I was born in 1994. So, ayun, 6 years apart talaga siya. Magkaiba yung groups. For me kasi, honestly, I don't know if echo chamber din lang or if it's my circles. Pero, ano ba? Hindi sa akin masyadong problema yung maka-encounter ng mga tao na hindi nakaka-filter ng groups. Kasi I think, at least my generation, sila yung mahilig, not man magbasa, pero sila yung mas exposed sa different news items, etc. Kasi hindi pa kami yung TikTok generation din eh. So I think as far as yung TikTok as a source of information is concerned, I think yung generation ko medyo spared in that sense. Pero agree ako dun sa sinabi din ko ni Ajay, na for the longest time, personally ako rin, hindi ko maintindihan kung bakit yung mga tao parang ang bilis maniwala sa kung ano-anong nakalagay online, especially the unverified articles or news items. Pero napagtanto ko rin po as time went by, especially when I started interacting with several people in the hospitals, in the clinics, na iba-iba talaga yung background. Hindi naman, wala silang luxury to sift through loads of information eh. So hindi din natin sila ma-blame kung ano yung makita sa kanila or kung ano yung exposure nila on a regular basis. Yun talaga yung paniniwalaan nila. Or for example, kung ano yung sinabi ng tita nila, ng nanay nila, kung anong nababasa nila sa Bible, for example. Siyempre frustrating na hindi sila mas cautious when it comes to looking at whatever's thrown at them. But again, you can't really blame them. So, ayun, feeling ko talaga it requires a lot of patience para subukan na mabago yung mga misconceptions. Nakakainis at times. Naalala ko parang yung sinasabi ngayon paulit-ulit ng nanay namin, yung mas radical yung magmahal. Malaking effort required on our part na frustrated talaga, na galit, to be a little more patient. With people, na ganito yung paniniwala. Pero, yun yung kailangan talaga natin, I guess, gawin. Kasi maraming napaniwala na sa fake news and sa ibang sources because of what's thrown at them din. Pero ayun, yun yung challenge sa atin, I guess. But maybe iba din yung perspective po ng aking Gen Z na kapatid na
Gen Z talaga.
Belong sa TikTok. Ewan ko, pero wala siyang TikTok.
Wala akong TikTok. So, I guess lahat tayo nagsabihan ko anong year tayo pinanganak. So, ako 2000 baby na ako. So, medyo malayo na talaga ako sa post-ed sa generation. But I think, ako personally, maswerte ako na, alam mo, kinikwentohan ako minsan ng mga lolas or even nila mama and papa kasi nag-meet sila right after ed. So, parang may knowledge talaga ako ano nangyayari at that time. But I think yung circle ko din or like yung echo chamber ko, yung iba at some point masuwok pa sa akin pagdating sa mga ganun. So maswerte din ako na wala ko masyado na yung encounter na alam mo yun, mabilis maniwala sa fake news. But I think yung generation ko nga, grabe on social media. And dahil ang dami mong content on social media na sinabi nga ni Ate Trish, parang kung ano-ano lang yung nababasa mo, medyo naniniwala ka na lang na pa-scroll-scroll ko na lang. I think ngayon, yung ibang volunteers, kahit mas nakakatanda ng generation, nag-download ng TikTok para gumawa ng TikToks na parang pang, alam mo yun, pang counter ng fake news na ang tagal na palang andon na hindi natin alam. So I guess yun lang, pagiging patient nga lang when it comes to combating all the fake news. Ano yun, I think hopefully, ma-add din siya into like our education system. I think meron naman sa araling panlipunan or sa social science, but kung mas may emphasize sana yun in the school curricular or curriculum, mas okay din. Okay.
Yeah, please go on. Continue.
And I don't know lang kung ngayon mas updated na siya. But ako remembering siguro from my grade school, ayun parang dinaanan lang. Pero hindi siya masyadong focused. So I guess if may i-improve in that aspect, so school-wise, hopefully, ma-add yun in the future. Para lang hindi makalimot habang tumatanda.
Do you think people, I mean the young, okay, general na yon from the 90s, so do you think they're indifferent now? Do they have an attitude na, we just wanna look for a job or perhaps migrate, ganyan. Parang they're indifferent about what's gonna happen or what's happening in the country.
Ako ma'am, I think, ako siguro, ma'am, well, parang I see it in faces. I think, for example, when I was younger, siguro when I was medyo fresh grad like Jillian, I think even my own personal views have evolved since then. Ako personally, I can't speak for my siblings, but I remember right after I graduated from college, alam niyo, medyo mas ko ano-ano yung wild ideas ko na, why aren't things this way, that way? Siguro mas less forgiving ako and less compromising than where I'm at right now. At that time, tingin ko medyo cool if I think differently compared to yung medyo dahil naiiba ka, tingin ko medyo cool ako noon. But parang ano, over time, I think si Tricia yata yung nakwentuhan ko nito. Like the elections next year, for example, a lot of people my age I see are lining up to register to vote. Kasi parang for them, yung feeling nila, yung at stake is the future of their kids. Kasi may mga friends ako ngayon, yung peers ko ngayon, may mga asawa, may mga anak na. And tingin ko, if this happened maybe 3 or 4 years ago, they're less invested. So tingin ko yung level of involvement, yung level of apathy, I guess, ng tao, nagbabago din, and my face, chest, and my cycle. So, kumbaga, hopefully, ideally, sustained siya all throughout. But at least, siguro, from my experience and from my observation, nag-iiba siya depending on, I guess, where you're at the stage of your life.
You have a question, Javi, or I can move on to the next one.
Actually, if I could ask a quick question related to that. Since we just talked about youth and involvement, for you guys, what do you think is the most concrete and solid way for the youth to contribute to your mom's campaign?
Well, I'll try to answer that. So add lang siguro muna dun sa question ni Mom Selma, no? I agree with my sister when she said na it comes in phases. Parang ako, yung feed ko wala pa namang mga anak, yung mga kaibigan ko. But then kami yung nagsisimula na sa kaibigan. Especially ako, kasi yung mga kaibigan ko po were fresh out of med school, were newly boarded. And of course, we're trying to figure out how we want our professional lives to be. And I won't lie, I have a lot of friends who said if the elections don't turn out the way they would hope it would be, gusto nang mag-migrate. Ganun yung iniisip ng mga kaedad ko ngayon. Sorry. Pero ayun po, for example, yung phases talaga, since kami, yun, we're trying to navigate our way for professional careers, I think yun yung mas pinag-isipan. And I think a lot of people my age then are more involved now because they can feel the direct effects of governance. And I think that's also to answer the question kung bakit yung ibang tao indifferent. I think part of the indifference is hindi naman nila nararamdaman what's in it for them. So I guess the transition into segment to answer Javi's question, I think yung pinaka-importance ng movement ng youth ngayon, ipaintindi sa mga tao kung paano ito nakaapekto sa mga buhay nila. And kung ano talaga yung at stake sa election, yung youth, I think yung energy nila very raw and very, alam mo yun, di pa pa talaga sa like, oh, sasayaw ako kung kailangan ko sumayaw. And I think we can really capitalize on that energy to reach the demographics and the population na hindi natin maabot. Kasi sila, masipag pa talaga sila eh. May energy pa sila. They're still very idealistic. So maybe we can use that energy talaga to help our cause, kumbaga. Siguro for example, yung ako, mahirap na for me kausapin yung mga kaedad ni Jillian. Hindi dahil lang, parang akala mo naman ang layo ng gap natin. Pero syempre, they speak different languages. What works for them, pwedeng hindi yun yung nag-work para sa mga groups ko. So, alam yun, mas creative sila. They know how to be more creative and more resourceful when it comes to speaking to people. So baka, ayun, pwede natin talaga magamit yung idealism nila, tapos yung rigor nila talaga. Ayun. So,
how about Jillian? How about...
I think on that point, yeah. I think, okay, karamihan din sinabi na ng sisters ko. But I think yung one thing na na-appreciate ko rin sa mga ka-age ko, yun nga, sobrang idealistic ng mga ka-generation. But then minsan, sila pa yung mas may energy or mas may confidence to criticize kung ano man yung mali. So I think isa lang yun na na-appreciate ko rin recently. Well, minsan parang nakakainis kumari na yung criticism for mom. But most of them naman, constructive criticism. So I think yun yung, alam mo yun, I think yung youth na ang daming fresh perspective na minsan hindi natin naiisip. Or like, at least, even yung sisters ko hindi naiisip or ako hindi ko naiisip. Na minsan pag binavoice out nila yung opinions nila on social media, sobrang valid naman. So yun. I think pag nakikita ko yung some of my friends na in my same group, maybe so may constructive criticisms online, talagang, alam mo yun, parang minimake sure ko na makakarating siya like kila ate or even kay mama sometimes. So,
what do you tell your friends who lost their jobs or who can't find work?
Well, lahat ng friends ko na
Aika and Dr. Trish, what do you tell? I'm sure there are people who are looking for jobs among your friends.
Well, there are some, but I think, ma'am, at my age, kasi they know that they just have to keep going. I mean, parang, I think a lot, many of my friends, many of us have been very frustrated with, especially sabihin natin, kahit ngayon pa lang, even the whole pandemic COVID response management. I think a lot are very frustrated. But parang parallel to the complaint, we also have responsibilities, we also have obligations, we have bills to pay. So kahit nagre-reklamo ka, you really have no choice but keep going. And I think that may be one of the reasons why a lot of my peers are very motivated to vote next year. Because alam nila na, you know, like what Tricia said earlier, they feel the direct impact of how governance can affect their daily lives. So, para may balance yung responsibilities and para ano na eh, medyo ano, I guess dahil nga yun, directly nararamdaman nila yung effect. Mas, kumbaga, I guess that's an added motivation for them to be more involved.
When your mom wins, what do you think should be her first priority?
I think, ma'am, she said this many times, but it's really the whole, how do we get out of the, how do we deal with COVID? Kasi that's going to be the pressing problem. Siya yung immediate na we really need to handle. Maraming ibang problema, pero ito yung urgent na this is actually something that we should have started to deal with last year, na better COVID response. But I think for sure, kasama yun sa mga urgent na programs niya. Everything else, siguro we'll probably let her answer na lang. But we're quite sure that COVID response is definitely kasama siya.
Okay, Javi, you have a question?
I do actually, related to that note on what your mom would first do if she gets elected to office. But since then, before that, pala, she's already done so much, you know, as a public servant, as the vice president. I guess my next question would be, what accomplishment of your mom are you guys each most proud of since she started serving on a national level?
Well, ako, like, alam ko naman usually yung ginagawa niya na programs, but I think on a more personal level, siguro kahit naging VP siya, even since 2016, parang kaya niya pa rin i-balance yung pagiging nanay sa amin and pagiging VP niya. So I think yun yung pinaka, alam mo yun, parang, ay, naghang ba ako?
No.
Wala ba ako?
No,
you're okay.
You're good.
Okay, I think naghang na siya.
Okay. Ayun. Okay, hindi ko siya gumagalaw, so ako na muna mag-carry over. But I think, ayan, nandun na ulit siya. Okay, go.
Ayan, sorry.
No.
Okay, naghang ulit siya. Hindi, pero ayun ko.
No, ayan.
Wait. Jill, ano, okay ka na ba?
Hindi, yeah, nalimutan ko.
Okay, go.
Okay na ba? Okay na ako?
Yeah, it's you're good.
Oh my God, I think maglalaro yung isa kong roommate. So, kaya baka ang bagal ng internet ko. Anyway, sorry. wait, anong sinabi nila ate? May sinabi na ba?
Wala ka. Mauna ka.
Okay. Wala ka. Hindi, I think sa akin lang, oh my God, I think lahat ng interviews yung mukha akong selfish kasi ako yung pinakamayayaw, tapos yung reason ko dahil walang oras para sa akin. Pero I think the last five years, like, minake sure niya talagang balanced yung pagiging VP niya and pagiging nanay sa aming tatlo and hindi nabawasan yung pagka-involve niya as a mom. So while proud ako sa lahat ng nagawa niya as a VP, I think pinaka-grateful pa rin ako na alam mo, hindi na wala yung presence niya sa bahay namin. And even nung nag-move ako to New York for college. So, before, si mama kasi, I think, alam naman ng most, but kung, I don't know, kung nakinig kayo sa podcast or something, alam niyo, super tiger mom siya. So I think before, parang, alam niyo, parang, oh my God, baka maging hands-off na sa amin. But even nung college na ako, naalala ko freshman year ko, may econ final ako. Parang nagka-cram ako for an econ final. And then alala ko si mama, siguro mga 2 p.m. nun in Manila, so 2 a.m. dito. Like, nagsusulat siya ng mga graph para ipakita sa akin yung supply and demand curve. Alam mo yun, parang hanggang doon sa point na yun, super involved niya pa yun. Na, wala, parang dun, nagpapakita din yun how dedicated she is sa kahit anong role man na ideals. So, it's either sa job man yun or sa pagiging nanay sa amin. I think, yun talaga yung proudest achievement ko pa rin na, alam mo yun, hindi kami napabayaan.
I think it was Aika who shared on the podcast na when you would come home from school for lunch break in Naga, your mom would review you pa rin during that lunch break.
Yeah. My index cards pa siya na color coded. So, naka-bind ba yun? Okay. So, minsan pag may homework na kami ng morning na binigay, ibibigay ko na sa kanya ng lunch. Tapos pagkahapon, pag nasa school ako, ginagawa nyo na. So,
ayun. May question na ako.
Ng homework ko.
So, niya nakukuha yung lahat ng energy na yun? Tsaka yung multi-talented. Parang like, di ba, recently ko, sa 2 weeks ago nung may bagyo, siya talaga yung nasa Twitter na siguro mga 1 o'clock na in the morning. Tapos, nababalance pa niya ngayon attending to the 3 of you.
I think number one, mahilig siya mag-aral kasi. Parang sa amin, siya yung whether, dati nung bago pa lang siya sa Facebook, sa Twitter, sa Instagram, matyaga siya kahit gano'n, mag-aral lang platform, mag-aral lang anything. Yun, siya yung pinakamasipag sa amin mag-aral. So, no, I think, ano talaga siya, parang sanay siya to always, I guess, give your 100%. Parang kahit ano, di ba? Whether yung pag-organize ng bahay namin or sa office, para di-lead siya ng response. Yung sa office naman, I think it's also because if you expect your team to perform really well, kailangan ikaw din yung mag-set ng tone for them. Kasi, di ba, parang, for example, if we work with a boss na sobrang sipag, sobrang hands-on, hihiya kang hindi to step up. So, I think, malaking factor dito.
But how many hours of sleep does she normally get? Lalo na ngayong, pakampi na talaga.
Ako ko, kami kasi nakikita namin yung agenda ng mom ko kapag busy ang taas eh. Na sometimes parang kung saan yung action talagang energetic siya. And I think binibiro namin siyang magkakapatid na we really see our dad and her. Kasi yung dad namin ganyan din talaga na parang pag may bagyo, instead na parang bumalik sa shell niya kasi bumabagyo siya pa lumalabas kasi grabe yung agenda. I think we can say the same thing about our mom. Yun, sinabi talaga ni ate na si mama mahilig mag-aral, mahilig siya sa mga activities. Kasi expectation niya talaga sa amin is to be our very best in whatever we do, whether it be in swimming, in piano, in debate, and whatever. Tinutulungan niya talaga kami to achieve that kasi yun din yung expectation niya sa amin. And ayaw niya nun mag-expect sa amin na wala siyang contribution. I think that's also one of the things that really motivates her to be energetic sa amin tatlo. Hours of sleep, I really don't know. I think it depends. But ako kasi I had the privilege or the nightmare to work with my mom again dun sa COVID response. Medyo intense yun. Ang daming beses nung time na yun na halos nag-aaway na kami. Hindi mo nag-aaway, pero nagkakaroon na kami ng disagreement. Ang dami talaga nangyayari. I was a volunteer doctor for one of the OVP efforts for COVID. Tapos nakita ko, feeling ko nun late na ako natutulog, pero pag-ising ko the following day and I see the tag sa thread namin, sa work thread namin, so yung last na natutulog. So there was a time, especially nung church, my mom would sleep at around 3 a.m., 4 a.m. And then 7 a.m. kapag sign-in na ulit ng bagong shift, ising na ulit siya. So na good morning sa lahat ng tao. So, I think kapag may sakuna po talaga, halos hindi natutulog si mama. Alam namin na pagod siya, pero gusto niya kasi ginagawa niya eh, and gusto niya hands-on siya. And again, going back to what I said a while ago, ayaw niya naman na may expect sa mga tao na hindi niya kayang gawin herself. So, ayun, leading by example, I think. And making sure na she's one of the team sa whatever work there is. So, ayun.
JJ, you have question? That's Luis Carlo, the editor of you.
Hi. What's the greatest life lesson you learned from either of your parents? Either your mom or your dad? Yeah, that one.
Parang ang hirap mag-isip na. Tama mo mga kapatid ko, madaya. O pag mahirap yung tanong, hinagaan din ito. It's really hard to think of just one. But siguro ano, I guess going back, medyo related to sa question ni Ma'am Thelma, na ano yung proudest siguro namin na ginawa ni Mama. Which I think related din sa answer ko dito sa life lesson. So si Mama kasi big on empowering other people. Parang for her, whatever role she takes on, parang gusto niya para maging enabler siya for other people to become the best versions of themselves. So kung titingnan natin even yung COVID response niya sa OVP, given the limited resources, they were able to maximize and bring different groups, different organizations together. And then raising us, kami mga anak, parang when she was younger, first lady siya ng Naga City, and then she was a law student, she became a lawyer, she's a mother. Parang sa kanya, willing to take on any role that would eventually enable other people close to her to become the people that they're meant to be. So, I always say na I don't think Papa would have turned out to be the public servant that he eventually was at the time nung peak niya, kung hindi siguro si Mama yung partner niya. Kaming magkakapatid, tingin ko, I think we turned out okay. And a huge credit of it goes to our mom. Pero parang tingin ko kasi yung tingin niya sa, siguro sa vocation or sa mission or sa goal niya. That whatever it is, it has to be in such a way that it enables other people to, it empowers and enables other people to live up to whoever they are meant to become. And siguro yun din yung one of the biggest lessons that I learned from my parents na syempre kami different fields, we worked in different capacities in different roles, pero in whatever capacity siguro that we find ourselves in, siguro conscious effort to become enabling of other people too. Like kung si Tricia, Doctor, si Jillian, mahaba pa yung, marami pa siyang pwedeng gawin. But regardless, siguro na where we end up, sana we are able to transform our different roles such that naging enablers din kami for other people.
Tricia, you have an answer.
Sana hindi ko maubusan si Jillian ng sagot kasi baka yun lang yung reklamo niya mamaya. Pero I think me and my sisters speak a lot about the kind of expectation na hinuhold sa amin ng mom na, that we have to be excellent, we have to be the very best Pokemon in whatever we do. But at the same time, I think more important yung ina-highlight nila sa amin ni Papa. For example, we go home with an 8 out of 10 in a test. Pagalitan kami, or pagkasabihan ko, but hindi tayo naka-perfect kahit nag-aral tayo. But at the end of the day, they would always say, mas okay na sa akin mag 4 out of 10 ka, basta mabuti ka pa rin na tao. And I think, no joke, nasabi nila yun at one time. Baka sa iisip ng mga tao, parang, pa-cute niya lang to. But they really did say that, na parang, important sa kanila na maging magaling kami, but ultimately, gusto na maging mabuti kami mga tao. Na parang the achievements and everything come secondary to your character. And I think that's what they were trying to emphasize or highlight sa aming magkakapatid habang lumalaki. Parang we have to keep our attitude in check always. Dapat maging mabait kami whatever we have as much as possible. Ibigay din namin sa mga nangangailangan. Ayun talaga po eh. Yung importance sa kanila, yung pagkatao mo. And I think yun yung isa sa pinaka important lessons na pinapaalala ko rin sa sarili ko. Na walang point yung mga achievements namin. Walang point yung awards. Kung yung core mo madumi o masama. Hindi ko sinasabi na perfect na namin yon. But I think of all the expectations that binigay sa amin ng magulang namin, yun talaga yung pinakamahalaga sa amin na kahit anong mangyari sa amin, sana magiging mabuti pa rin kami. Sana okay naman kami. Pero ayun po yung lagi namin. Yun yung, that's what we always hold ourselves.
Si Jillian. Hirap naman sundan. Hirap naman sundan ang dalawang yun. But I think sa akin, siguro yung main lesson ko din, well, aside dun sa dalawa na sinabi nila, kasi mas maganda yung answer. But I think kasi pareho si Papa and si Mama super consistent nila in what they do. So I think si Papa sobrang tagal niya naging mayor. And alam mo yun, parang hindi lang siya okay. Nung first term ko lang, ako magiging okay. And then, alam mo yun, parang idadrag mo na lang yung mga nagawa mo for the first term dun sa consecutive terms. So I think minake sure niya talaga na, alam mo yun, kung ano yung ginawa niya from day one, yun yung gagawin niya until hanggang kaya gawin yung ginagawa niya. Gets mo? So until the last day, dapat consistent talaga yung effort na pinapakita mo. Or yung basta binibigay mo lang lahat. And I think with Mama, ganun din. So pareho talaga nila napakita sa akin na parang, alam mo yun, medyo long. Alam mo yun, parang dapat mahaba-haba talaga yung endurance when it comes to life. So, alam mo yun, para lang lagi lang consistent yung mga pinapakita mo. So I think whether that's in school or in work, alam mo yun, para everyday nag-show up ka, give your best. And ayun, hopefully yun yung ginagawa na. Well, sana yun yung nasa isip ko rin parate, like whether in school or in like a summer job. So, ayun. From marketing manager si Ben Roque, ang question niya is to, should she win, who among you will act as first lady? And second is, will you allow your mom to have a love life? Nakamute kayo lahat.
Well, second daughter ho, so definitely not the first lady. Kasi ate ay.
So then bunso ako, so...
Oh, guys. Okay. Actually, ma'am, it's something we haven't really talked about. I think if kami naman ready kami, una, I don't think she will let us put our lives on hold just so we can help her. Although, ano naman, alam niya naman na anytime na kailangan namin mag-step up, we will be there. Pero I think it's conscious effort din. I think papagalitan pa nga kami kung ano, if we end up pausing or taking a leave or something from what we normally do just to be able to take on a role na kailangan. Yung number two, baka yung mga kapatid ko na may sumagot.
Ano nga yung number two na question? Sorry. Yung love life. Okay.
Will you allow her to have a love life?
Well, honestly, I think hindi talaga pa yung pagka-selfish ko. And ayoko na eh. Like, Papa is the only one for me. Kung ako tatanungin personally, this was my answer when I was 18, and this is still my answer at 27. I really can't imagine my mom with anyone else. And I think she made it clear naman na... Oh, naging defensive bigla. I think she made it clear that she doesn't see herself also going out romantically in that feeling. Yeah, wala na akong matatagdag pa doon. Aside from, for me, kung ako yung tatanungin personal reference, ayoko na po sana. Sana enough yung love na nabibigay namin tatlo sa kanya. Yun lang yung hope ko ngayon. As for yung sinabi nga po ni Ate Ice about first lady, etc., wala po talaga kami na pag-uusapan anything in the future. We take it one day at a time. So, yung mga ganyan po talaga hindi pa natin pinag-uusapan. And yun nga po, si Mama talaga ayaw ma-disrupt yung mga buhay namin. Jillian wanted to come home to help out. Pero siya na yung nagsabi, mas masistress siya knowing na hininto ni Jillian yung senior year niya because of her. Kahit po nung tumakbo sa fraternity, hindi ako nang pinayagan mag-leave of absence from medical school. Si Jillian hindi pinayagan. Nag-leave of absence from high school. Hindi, pero hindi din po siya pinayagan nun na to put her life on hold for that. But, ayun nga po yung sinabi ni Ate Ike na kung kailangan naman namin mag-step up, willing naman po kami tatlo. Ayun, willing naman kaming tatlo kung anong kailangan niya. Pero whatever efforts we do, for example, kung yung ako yung pag hindi ko pagtuloy yung training, that is a personal decision, hindi naman siya humingi nun sa amin. And I think yun din yung pinaka-disclaimer namin mga magkakapag-important yung gagawin ni mama, hindi naman humingi yung full-time. So, ayun. Maka Jillian din, yung masagot.
Jillian, your answer. I think sinabi na ni Ate Tricia. So I think nung leading up to the announcement, gusto ko talaga umuwi. But one, hindi pwede because of quarantine. So hindi rin ako aabot. And nung nag-iisip ako na parang, oh, baka pwede ako mag-leave of absence. Like, I'll finish the semester and take a leave of absence next semester. Parang hindi talaga yun, parang never siya naging option for mama. You know, pwede ako umuwi pag may long breaks. Pero, alam mo, parang gagraduate na rin ako a few days after election. So, para for them talaga hindi siya option to stop what we're doing. Kasi, alam mo, may sarili din kaming buhay and hindi niya ina-expect na full-time kami tutulong kahit gusto namin.
Okay. So, last three questions. Two questions from Jackie Aquino, the fashion director, and then last question will be from Javi. Yung kay Jackie is, what do you think is, what is your hope for the Filipino, and what do you think is your mom's biggest challenge now that in her campaign?
I think yung biggest challenge ngayon na unti-unti, parang ang hirap for me to rank siguro the biggest challenge kasi ang dami talagang challenges. Among them, yung misinformation, yung pagkakalat ng misinformation, ang dami pa rin fake news, how do we combat fake news. And siguro yung second na challenge din, which parati ko naaalala when Papa was still mayor of Naga. Parang pag tinatanong mo siya, how do you envision Naga City? Parang sinasabi niya, yung pinakapangarap niya is, he wants the Nagenos to be proud of themselves, to be proud na product sila ng Naga, to be proud of the city where they came from. And I think marami tayong problema as a country ngayon. And yung challenge and yung pinaka-dream din siguro is hopefully working together, parang slowly makatayo ulit, slowly hindi na tayo maging as polarizing as before. Hopefully, we focus more on our similarities rather than the differences that divide and polarize us now. And siguro yung willingness and openness to listen and to work with people we don't normally spend our time with. Kasi lalo na next year, para important talaga na we're all focused on the bigger goal, on the bigger picture. Sana despite differences here and there, makahanap ng way for all of us to come together and work together.
Tricia.
Siguro yung sa challenge, yung sasagot na rin naman ni Ate Ike. So, but I think yung dream at least for the country. Yun nga po yung kunento ko sa inyo kanina na marami akong mga kaibigan na gusto nang umalik to. I don't see anything wrong about going abroad kasi ako, I believe it exposes you to so many other things na makakatulong talaga sa development mo as a person, your professional career, etc. But I hope people don't, parang yung dream ko for the Philippines is sana hindi kailangan ng mga tao iwan yung mga pamilya nila dito just to get work or just to find opportunities to better pay. ako, wala naman po akong karanasan basically sa mga OFW family. Simply ako OFW ko ay nung umalis si Ada ay for Harvard for a year. And yung pag-alis ni Jillian for college. Yun lang yung pinaka-experience ko sa having someone away. Totoo, nakaka-miss ko na ako nga ilang taon lang ba wala si Ada or ilang taon lang wala si Jim. And naramdaman ko talaga na na-miss ko sila. Pero what more sa mga families na kailangan talagang mag-iwalay for a time just because walang maayos sa trabaho dito. Sana hindi na ganun. Aside from being proud of where you are, I hope Filipinos don't feel the need that they have to seek for opportunities elsewhere kasi nagkukulang dito sa atin. At ramdam na ramdam ko po yan sa mga kaedad ko ngayon. Kasi gusto na talaga umalis kasi pakiramdam nila doctors aren't treated the way they're supposed to be treated or aren't compensated the way they should be compensated. Yung mga katrabaho pong nurses ngayon din sa ospital, I don't blame them for wanting to go abroad kasi kailangan talaga nilang kumita para sa pamilya nila. Sana dumating tayo sa point na hindi na talaga kailangan magsiwa-hiwalay ng mga magkakapamilya because of that reason. So siguro yun yung yun sa mga pangarap ko for the Philippines. Wow. Pero ayun, yun yung sa mga ano ko talaga, sa mga hope ko para sa atin.
Yeah. That's so shared by everyone. Jillian, you have your take.
I think sa akin lang medyo similar kay Ate Ike when it comes to yung medyo pangarap mo para sa Pilipinas. Siguro kasi ako, ano ba ako, like 15 ako nung, like medyo around 15 ako nung 2016 elections. And I think yun talaga yung nagsimula na, na sobrang polarizing na ng, alam mo yun, ng karamihan ng tao sa bansa. Or alam mo yun, parang kung may sarili kang political affiliation, medyo categorized na as o dito ka or dito sa kabila. And hopefully, sana in the next few years, mas maging inclusive. Lahat ng tao, hindi lang mga cupcakes or something. But, alam mo, lahat talaga ng tao na parang okay lang naman nga na may disagreement on some issues. But alam ko naman na lahat tayo gusto lang ng better lives for everyone. So, I think isa ko sa sinabi nung Saturday, may in-attended din akong event dito sa New York. Parang, hopefully sana mas konti na yung mga debates surrounding different issues. Pero mas, ngayon, mas conversational na lang and hopefully konti na lang yung pag-away. Parang, ang hirap, especially for our generation and even yung mga mas bata pa sa akin, hindi kaya mag-vote na lumaki sa Pilipinas na ganito ka-divided. So, hopefully, yun lang.
Habi, your question? You have question, Habi?
Yeah, I do. Just one last quick one. Thank you for all your answers so far, by the way. Previously, you've talked about all the lessons that you've learned from your parents. And because of these lessons, you've all gone on to accomplish such praiseworthy things, despite all the challenges that your family has faced and all the sacrifices that you had to make for the country. Amidst all that, how do you guys take care of your mental health? And what tips can you give to the youth who are struggling to take care of their mental health during this pandemic?
Right?
Yeah.
I think for us, siguro dyan kami nahihirapan din mag-balance. Kasi especially kaming tatlo, even with our mom running, parang it's so easy to say ayaw namin siya tumakbo because it's bad for our mental health, which it really is bad for our mental health, pero kailangan naming i-balance siya, I guess, with some of the other responsibilities na hindi ka pwede umatras from different things, maybe because of that. So like kaming during the pandemic, kaming tatlo, medyo dun kami nag-exercise regularly. I think it's really more self-care na focus on the things within your control. Pero at the same time, siguro very mindful kami parate na we just don't use it as an excuse to back out of our responsibilities. Kasi parang ultimately, ano pa rin eh, we have to look after ourselves, but at the same time, binabalance mo rin siya ng mga obligations that you have to fulfill at the end of the day?
Tricia.
Julian, okay. Yun, agree ako din sa sinabi ni Ate Ike. So ngayon, alam mo parang little doses of self-care na lang. Parang kung ano nagpapasaya sa'yo. Like, may exercise ako on the other hand, pero kung gusto ko kumain, kakain din ako. Ayun, yun, para medyo happy or like skincare, meron akong one episode ng Friends. Alam mo yun, parang, or yung favorite movie ko, Parent Trap, or gano'n. But I think especially leading up to, yun nga, the announcement, I think ako personally, medyo yung mental health ko bumaba talaga at that time. So, yung tinakbuhan ko syempre yung mga sisters ko. I think kung may company na, alam mo, nakaka good vibes. good vibes kayo guys. Nakakapa good vibes. Alam mo, parang okay talaga nalapitan sila. Huwag mag-hesitate na mag-reach out to, alam mo yun, your friends or your family. I think very important talaga to have a strong support system. And honestly, kung gusto mo ng one day na like ako ginawa ako din yun, I think healthy din to let it out. May outlet ka. I think yung joke sa akin ng mga sisters ko, ako yung type na iiyak ako, kunwari mag-a-alarm ako, kunwari may test ako. Mag-a-alarm ako, sabi natin, from 10 to 10:15. Iiyak lang ako, hayaan ko sarili ko umiyak. And then after 10:15, mag-a-alarm ako. Kasi hindi naman tumitigil yung ikot ng mundo kung iyak ka lang ng iyak. So, maybe yun talaga balance na lang. Ayun. Take some time and then after, laban ulit.
Doctor? Well, ayun po. Katulad, I think, mix of both answers. Ako po kasi nun yung pa-announce din yung mom ko about running. May mga duties ako lang sa ospital. Alam nga naman, hindi ako mag-duty kasi umiiyak ako. So, ayun po talaga. Parang, we have to strike the balance between letting ourselves grieve for a while or letting ourselves na i-express yung mobs namin express, but at the same time, hindi namin pinapabayaan yung mga responsibilidad namin. In terms of mental health, the past couple of years have been really tough for me and my sisters. Of course, for my mom also. And it's something I would admit to, I had to, and something I'm not embarrassed to talk about. I had to seek help because I had to let it all out. And I feel like sometimes it's not wrong to seek professional help, especially if you feel like you need it. Hindi masamang mag-open up, hindi masamang makipag-usap kung yun talaga yung kailangan mo. Pero syempre, hindi naman po lahat may luxury na maghanap ng professional help. So, katulad ng sabi ng mga kapatid ko, it's important also to look for things na kaya mong gawin on your own. For me, it helps maging productive at a time na very stressful. Whether it be exercise, magluto ka, yung skincare mo, or manood ka ng episode, it can be as simple as that. Something just to get your mind off, alam mo yun, yung stressful emotions, yung stressful thoughts. Tingin ko nakakatulong yun. Pero ayun nga, at the end of the day, it's important to strike the balance between, ayun, sa responsibilities talaga. Especially sa edad siguro namin, sal na ni Ate Ike, na may trabaho mong naghihintay at hindi yun gagalaw kung hindi mo siya galawin. So, give yourself time, but at the same time, don't ignore the responsibilities that you have. Pero syempre, mas magiging productive ka with your work if you're okay. So, aside from powering too, ayun, you have to give yourself time to breathe and you have to give yourself time to relax a bit. And, ayun. Yun, I think yun yung mga ginawa namin the past couple of days and the past couple of weeks.
Hey, thanks a lot. I know you guys are all busy and, you know, let's hope for the best and try our best to be doing.
Yes. Ma'am, thank you for also inviting us today. Buti timing na may common time kami.
Oo, salamat ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.